Welcome to the seventh EasyBuild TED Talk. In this, we will be having two of the teams from the student cluster competition at ISC'22. We'll present about their experiences and to give us some information and some time for question and answers. The first of these teams is NotOnlyFlops, who'll be talking about the unconventional cluster of RISC-V developer boards and their experiences with them. So over to this team.
Okay, thank you, Simon. Thank you for the introduction, and also thank you to all the organizers for inviting us. We are, Martin and myself, are two of the advisors of this team. We are here in the back in case of questions, but the real important message will be given by the students that are here. So it's their moment. So I just wanted to thank you for inviting us, and I leave the word to them. We stay here in case of nasty question. Be nice, please. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you everyone for being here. I'm Xavi, and I'm going to explain a little bit about. Okay, about what is the student cluster competition and what we did there. So, what is the student cluster competition? Firstly, there are two big conferences around the world of high performance computing every year. And the main two are, well, not the main two, but there is one in Europe, which is the ISC, which takes part between May and June, and the other one, which takes part in the United States, and it's in November. So each conference hosts the student cluster competition, and you can think about the conference when people go there to give talks and all that stuff, but there is also an exhibition with where companies have their own booth and they show their technologies and they do also talks. So now us, the students, in this competition, we have our own booth. And as you can see in these images, there are from the previous competitions. So how does the student cluster competition work? Basically, you have to take in mind that these were the rules before COVID-19 and now have changed a little bit. So the rules were that there were 12 teams of 600 graduate students plus the advisors, and each team has to bring its own cluster. Also, each cluster has a power budget of 3 kilowatts, so you cannot exceed this power. So as you can see in these images, there is these red lines here. And if some teams with each cluster pass this red line, you get disqualified by some points. Also, there are three applications which you have to compile them, run them, and do also some benchmarks. And these are some real scientific application. Plus, on the last day, there is a circuit application, which we will talk about it later. There are also three awards, and one is for the highest HPL, which takes Limpac, the first place winner, and the fan favorite one. Now, about our student cluster competition, we were between COVID times, so we had two parts, the online and the on-site part. The online one took part between March to May, and the council gave us access to three supercomputers around the world, which we will talk about these its architectures later. And also we were asked to also run and compile and do some tasks that were provided by the jury to three real scientific applications, which I will talk later. And on the on-site part, we brought our cluster there, and there were the same rules as mentioned on the last slide. Also, the main difference could be that instead of being 12 teams, this year we were 5 teams of 600 graduate students plus the advisors. As I just stated, there were three applications. The first one was NWChem, which is a computational chemistry package. You can think about it as an Excel of computational chemistry. It is written in Fortran, and it uses OpenMP and MPI with global arrays. It also has support for multi-core CPUs and GPUs, and it's open source. It was created in the 90s, and a curiosity could be that this application is older than the MPI and even older than us. And this application is still maintained by some laboratories and some developers. The other application was ICON, which means icosahedral non-isostatic Earth system model, and it's a weather prediction and climate modeling system. It's used in the German Weather Service and it's written in Fortran. It also uses MPI and OpenMP, and there is a work in progress that it could be ported to GPUs. The last application was XCompact 3D, and it's a solver dedicated to the study of turbulent flows. It's also written in Fortran, and it was initially designed in France in the mid-90s. It was supposed to be used in serial processors, but later it was converted for HPC systems. And it also uses MPI. And now I'm going to leave the word to my colleague Enric, who is going to explain a little bit about the team.
Okay, thank you, Xavi. So the NotOnlyFlops team has been active since 2015 when it was created and started participating in student cluster competition. Since then, there have been 8 different teams, and every year there's a new team that is formed, and it's formed through a selection process that the advisors from the Barcelona Supercomputing Center prepare. We are not afraid to use new or emerging or unexpected technologies, because we think that is more about learning and having fun than the flops we get. So that's exactly why the team's called NotOnlyFlops. We don't like making up excuses and leaving a challenge unaccepted. So being online or on site, we work really hard on each part. Also, we think that this is not an every team member on his own type of competition. So we collaborate with each other, and every time the skill of another member can be useful, we use that to be more efficient. And we think that the SCC is the door to the HPC world. Now it's time for you to meet the team. We are Xavi, Miquel, Roc, Eric, Marc, and me, Enric. We have all just finished our third year at Universitat Politecnica de Catalunya. Two of us are studying computer science, another 2 computer engineering, and the other 2 software engineering. The place in the Facultat d'Informatica de Barcelona is actually very close to the Barcelona Supercomputing Center. That's the place where our advisors spend most of their time. Because all of this could not have been possible without the help of our advisors, who are Marta, Guillem, Filippo, Kilian, and Fabio. They are all researchers at the Barcelona Supercomputing Center and have been and still are a huge help through all the learning process. And now my friend Miquel will present you the adventure with our RISC-V cluster.
So firstly, I'm going to introduce what is RISC-V itself. For those of you who don't know, RISC-V is an emerging new technology. It's an open source ISA, and we think it's the perfect playground for research, because not only it means that it's community developed and also that companies can take part in its development actively, like SciFive or StarFive, but it is also a modular ISA. So this enables to have RISC-V machines from embedded systems to high-performance CPUs, and also specific CPUs like GPUs or other accelerators can be made using this architecture. Also, one thing we're proud is that our Barcelona Supercomputing Center is working on different research projects to further develop this architecture, and we think they'll see light in a few time. About the cluster itself, we cannot talk about it without having in mind the adventure we had trying to get a nice cluster. Because in March 21st, we contacted the RISC-V International, which is the organizational who standardizes the RISC-V development, and we asked them for help in finding a cluster. So they put us in contact with a Shanghai StarFive team, and we tried to agree to have a cluster from them. But a week later, on March 28th, Shanghai went on lockdown due to COVID-19 resurgence. So logistics from and to Shanghai became challenging, and it was completely unfeasible to have the cluster for the competition. So two months prior to the competition, we were left without a cluster to go in. Fortunately, a month later, during the RISC-V week at Paris, we got the chance to meet other RISC-V enthusiasts. And during the event, we talked to E4 and to the Universitat di Bologna, and we agreed to collaborate in order to have a cluster for our NotOnlyFlops team. So finally, we get to the competition site on May 30. And basically, we have a cluster which is a compound of two parts, one from Bologna and one from the Barcelona Supercomputing Center, which we will have to set up in order to work. So our cluster had some limitations from the start, because even before starting it, powering on our cluster, we knew that it would be slower comparing to other Intel machines, because in other words, floating point peak performance is 16 times lower because of the design of the architecture. And also it had limitations in network, because only a gigabit Ethernet network type was supported. InfiniBand is still not supported yet, or at least in our models. So we couldn't get it work any faster than that. And also the maximum power that it used were 300 watts. That's a 10% of the power, because we couldn't get more boards available for our cluster. If we had the chance to get more boards, we could have had more power, computational power. And that was a big handicap to begin with. But nevertheless, we got a cluster which was fully functional and working. The cluster was based on 7 boards from the Barcelona Supercomputing Center and 6 boards from the Universitat di Bologna. The 6 ones inside the racks, like you can see in the picture on the left, were the ones from Italy, and the top of the rack ones were the ones landed from Barcelona Supercomputing Center. And you know, well, once we got there, we had to set it up for the first time ever, make all the boards work together, and we successfully achieved that. And also we had to state that our cluster, it really uses ARM, because our Raspberry Pi was acting as a DHCP server to isolate an internal network for all the boards. So that's basically it. And now we are going to talk about the preparation at home in order to reach the on-site part.
Now I'm going to talk about the 6 months before going to traveling to Hamburg. On the first stage of this month, we got an introduction to high-performance computing, because we all come from university and we only have 1 or 2 subjects about parallel programming and architectures. So we didn't know how to submit jobs on a big cluster like the ones we are going to use in this competition. The first we did was to submit the typical benchmarks like HPCG or LIMPACT in machines from Barcelona Supercomputing Center. Then when the judges let us the applications, we started to compile and study them in order to get the best configuration to have the best performance on also a computer from Barcelona Supercomputing Center. Finally, when the online competition started, the judges let us access to the supercomputers from Pittsburgh Supercomputing Center and University of Toronto. And we also started to compile and run and get the outputs in those machines. Then when we got all the outputs, we submitted the results. And finally, you started using RISC-V clusters, such as the words we took to Hamburg, which was another cluster from BSC called RISC-V, with the same words that we use in Hamburg. Now, my colleague Enric will talk about the adventures on site.
Thanks, Mark. Now I'm going to talk about our experience in Hamburg. Well, the first day, we had to take the flight to Hamburg, and our advisors made us to put in our luggage part of the clusters that we were going to take to the competition. Once there, we went to the exhibition and got the rest of the notes that lent us the University of Bologna to start mounting the cluster. This day was totally dedicated to the hardware part of the cluster. On the second day, we installed all the system software, configuring Slurm, installing on the benchmarks, downloading the application source code and the dependencies. This was the first day that we worked with a RISC-V cluster, so it was a challenging day. The next day was the benchmark day, so we had to execute HPCG, HPL, and HPCC. We executed them with a configuration that allowed us to get the results on time. Also, this day we started compiling the applications for the next day. XCompact, Icon, NWKM. And at that moment, we realized that the compilation took a long time. That was going to be one more problem, since it limited us even more the time and the number of different configurations that we could carry out. The fourth day was the applications day. So once we had the competition input, we launched an execution to estimate the execution time of an iteration. Then we adjusted the number of iterations of the input to be able to finish the execution and had valid results within the time limit. All the problems and how we solve them will be explained later. The last day, we had to compile and execute the secret application, which was false-free, which we didn't know anything about until that day. The work plan was similar to the other applications. Each one of the group compiled with different configuration, and once compiled, we adjusted the iterations to the available time. After delivering the results, we mounted the cluster and we went to the award ceremony. As you can see in the image, during the ceremony, we received the Frame Favorite Award for all the work we do and for doing something unusual and innovative. Now, my colleague will explain how the process was and the problems we had with each application.
Okay, so first we're gonna talk about XCompact 3D. And this was the easiest one application because it doesn't have any dependencies. So we only had to load the corresponding modules that you can see that are GCC on OpenMPI and compile it. We also managed both to run it in single node and multiple nodes. The only thing that we had to modify was the size of the input given by the judges, because our cluster was slower than the rest. So we decreased from 10,000 iterations to 100 iterations.
Okay, and for the Icon application, we could successfully compile it, but we realized that when using the GCC version, the same as the XCompact 3D, that's the 10.3.0, and the OpenMPI 4.1.1, it would give us a crash, but we didn't know, like we didn't have enough time to figure that out. So what we did was to switch to MPitch for the MPI wrapper, and then it compiled without much problem. This application had dependencies, more precisely HDF5 and NetCDF, both the C and the Fortran versions. And Another dependency it had was UCX for InfiniBand, but there's no support for UCX in RISC-V yet. And when we tried to compile it from ourselves, from the source code, we got an error saying that RISC-V architecture was not supported yet. And we are not aware like if someone has successfully managed to do it yet or not. So what we did was to move forward without this without this prerequisite. And then the execution in a single node worked finally, both in a serial and using multiple core executions. But then when trying to execute in a multi-node execution, it would crash using for a segmentation fault. And because of time limitations, we couldn't figure out like what would be the cause of it. Because as my colleague said previously, like the compilation and the execution took much longer than when comparing to other machines. So we also had to reduce the simulation input. Like the original one was for 1 year and our run was for 1 day to give a number of how much difference in computational power there are.
About NWK, we could compile the application, but not at the first time. So in the first time, we tried to compile it with the GCC, the OpenMPI, and OpenBlast, but we couldn't get to run this application. We don't know why, but we were lucky because we had the main developer there, who is Jeff Hammond, and who is the main developer of this application. He told us to change some flags and also to change the OpenMPI to mpeach. So once we changed this stuff, we could manage the application to compile and to run in one node. But when we tried to run this application in multi-node, it crashed, and it was because of an issue with a malloc. So we talked another time with Jeff, and he told us that maybe this issue was not related to our configuration, but we don't know it yet, as this application was never tried to run in a RISC-V based cluster. So maybe in a few time, this application will run smoothly there.
And the last application was the secret application, which is Fall3D, which is a Fortran-based application that simulates the passive transport of volcanic particles, aerosols, and radiation. We managed to compile it with GCC and OpenMPI. We also had to set up some dependencies, which were HDF5 and NetsDF, but we got it to execute it in single node and multi-node in our first try. We had to reduce the input from 55 hours to 1 hour. But a fun fact about this application is, as you said in one of your previous presentation, in one given by Kenneth, the validation tests were not maintained. So all the tests failed for our cluster setup, but the application actually was working successfully.
Okay, so now I'm going to talk about what we have learned through the online competition and the on-site competition, because we, in the on-site competition, we brought a RISC-V cluster. So like the rest of the teams, we had to set up the cluster and make it run the day before the competition started. This is why we had a limited time to do it. But we also had to pack the cluster in our luggage because we had a part of it in the BSC. Bringing motherboards and power supplies in the suitcases was a little bit suspicious, but we didn't get arrested in the airport security control. We also learned how to compile applications in Intel and AMD based clusters, because in the online competition, the clusters that were given to us were of this kind. But we also learned how to compile these applications in a RISC-V cluster that is an uncommon architecture. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about what we learned compiling and running these applications. In the online competition, we could follow the guides provided by the judges and make and compile the applications and run it and run them without much problems. We only had several problems with ICON. But in the onset competition, we had to find alternative configurations since the guides provided to us were thought of for Intel and AMD based clusters. For example, in MBGM, the default communication between nodes was set to InfinityBand, and we had a 1 gigabit Ethernet interconnection. Another thing that we had to do in the competition was to measure the power drain, but well, since our cluster only consumed 300 watts, we didn't bother about that. So we had to focus on measuring the compilation and execution time, since the time in the onset competition was very limited. And then since we were bringing a cluster based on an uncommon architecture, we liked to build all the dependencies and the software ourselves for avoiding any problems in the future. That in a common base cluster, you can directly install the software, and you don't expect any problems. But since we had an uncommon architecture, we wanted to know what flags and used in the compilation of that software. So that has been a little bit a summary of our experience. So now, if you have any questions, we will be glad to answer them.
Hey, thank you very much. This was really interesting. I can definitely come up with several questions, but let's see if anyone else has a question here in the Zoom session. If you do, please raise your hands. I will let you raise the question, or if you're watching through the YouTube live stream, maybe post it in the EasyBuild Slack and let us know if you have any questions. While people prepare their questions or think about a question, I have one or two. So you mentioned you had quite a bit of issues compiling, because the compiling directly on the RISC-V boards is quite slow. They don't have a lot of cores, don't have a lot of memory. So maybe even ran into memory issues as well at some point. Did you consider cross-compiling? So having a more powerful Intel server, for example, and then cross-compiling for RISC-V, or compiling in an emulated environment on an Intel system, because that's probably a lot faster than building directly on the RISC-V port.
So,
with our resources, we thought adding a cross-compiling option would be like a layer of complexity, and we didn't have like the resources or the time necessary to implement that in that moment. That's why we did it all in the RISC-V cluster itself.
Yeah, and we also only tried the RISC-V cluster in the on-site competition. So before, we didn't have any access to the cluster, so we couldn't try that.
Okay. I guess you only learned how painful it was to compile software from source during the actual competition. Yeah.
It was already too late.
It was already too late to then, yeah. Okay. And another question I had, that's maybe a more general thing, but you described the application quite well and the dependencies. So it's mostly compiler, MPI, and then some pretty standard libraries like HDF5 and etcdf. Is that typical for this type of competition? Because in my experience, a lot of applications in HPC are way more complex than that, have more dependencies or dependencies that you only see for some applications and nowhere else. So something common as NetCDF and EasyFive is maybe easy. Now it's probably not easy on RISC-V, but in general, maybe there's a reason they do this as well for the competition. Otherwise, it would be too extreme or too difficult. But is this typical?
Well, maybe I can take this question because I had previous experiences. I think that the idea that guides the judges or the organizers of the competition is that usually they take something that has a community-driven HPC application, right? They were open form, quantum espresso, this kind of, say, big scientific applications with whatever they came from, right? So you are right, it can happen, and it happened in the past to have applications that were like a little bit more hard to have up and running. But the basic idea is that you have real science there. And yeah, sometimes when it is too hard, the judges, they know and they try to at least give you an input that do not use all the models that are, say, the weirdest one. So usually they tend to be nice. But yeah, in other years, we had problems in finding. For example, I remember one year that we were going with an ARM system and they gave us an application with Intel intrinsics. So whenever you find that, I mean, it's not a fact that you can change MPI flavor and you go on, right? You really have to recode it or understand what to do. So yeah, it can happen. You're right.
And so the applications, except for the surprise one, how much time did you have to prepare to experiment with the applications, building them, maybe preparing scripts to build them more easily? Was that something that was allowed? Stuff that you could reuse during the competition?
Yeah, this is allowed. Yeah, usually you get the application a couple of months before. And then, yeah, we document it in the wiki in case of somebody forget about it when the time pass goes by, right? But then you can also script it. And yeah, this is all allowed.
And during the competition, you're then supposed to start from an empty system. You have to image the nodes and then pull in those scripts, download the source code, and basically start from scratch.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's a big challenge. Okay. There's another question coming in from someone else. So both application 2 and 3 were built using MPage, but only application 3 ran fine on multinode while application 2 failed because of UCX. Is that correct? And maybe you can say something more about that. Why did it work for the third application and not for the second one? Do you have any idea?
So if we had had more time, I think we would have got to the real issue on why that happened. But still, like, I think like there are so many variables in it that we cannot assure it was for one single thing. Maybe it was like a accumulation of files that made the thing that didn't work, but we cannot assure a single thing.
And so the second application failed with a SEC fault, right? Do you think that could be due to the amount of memory that's available on the boards, and then maybe big stuff being created in memory, and it just assumes that enough memory will be available and then goes down hard if that's not the case? You wouldn't always, yeah, you would expect a nicer error message, but we see SEC faults a lot when just there's not enough memory. Yeah.
Like it cannot be, it could be perfectly possible. Like we do not know, and we should trace a bit more the error to get a proper understanding of it.
Also, I mean, as a method, if it would have been in, say, more time in preparation for the RISC-V, with the RISC-V cluster, we could have, like, take the application, compile it, and run it with the smaller input set or with tests, and try to move on from there. But in this case, was everything really quick quick to do. I mean, we didn't have time to start with the basic test or the small inputs and then moving to complex runs, right? So that basically limited a little bit our level of understanding.
How much sleep did you have during the competition? How much sleep did you have, the students, during the competition? Did you lose sleep while trying to fix problems?
I mean, you are in a conference and it's, I think at midnight they close it. So you have to get out and they kick you out, right? So you continue reasoning about it, but at some point you sleep.
Or cry
and sleep, something like this.
Okay, there's also it's maybe not a question, more of a comment by Alan, that Fortran seems to be a little bit overrepresented, at least in this set of applications. And actually for RISC-V, that's maybe a downside, because we know there's a lot of ongoing development in LVM, for example, for RISC-V, but there's also a lot of development for Fortran. It's not really mature yet. So I guess that that could have been an interesting direction, or maybe it is for next year. If there's a more mature LVM-based tool chain and you decide to continue this adventure with RISC-V, that could be interesting. Oh yeah, and a question by Alan as well. What was the experience like as students? Did you learn a lot, and do you love or hate HPC now?
Well, it was hard at first, because we started here in December or January, more or less, and we barely know anything. So it was a big challenge for us. For example, personally, I didn't know what a module was. So now I know what it is. So that's the level. So now we know how to maybe build some applications from scratch, how to run it, and maybe to extract some information to increase the performance. And that's basically what I learned. And I don't know about my colleagues.
Yeah, for me, I didn't know much about HPC. So yeah, it was the first experience with it, and I liked it, so.
I think that summarizes it.
Yeah. Okay. No, sounds good. I'll pass the word to Simon.
sorry, it was Jordan. Go on, please.
Okay. I'll pass the word to Simon here to see if we can make the switch over to the other team, unless there's any other questions or any final words from you guys. Thanks a lot. I think this was a very good presentation, very interesting to get an insight on what it's like to join a competition like this. And I hope this was fun. It was recorded as well, so and maybe this was a bit better than the let's say interesting interview you had during the competition itself. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, back to Simon. We'll switch over to the other team to hear their experience as well. I'll be right back, but I think Simon has things under control.
I think we are still missing a member who was supposed to give the general introduction. There he is.
All right.
Sorry, I will.
The first thing, thanks for having us here today.
And just give me one moment, I'll introduce you as a team quickly first, and then I'll pass across to you.
Okay.
So our second talk today, or second discussion, is with the team RACKlette, and they used EasyBuild to install software for their more traditional CPU-GPU cluster. So I'll pass over to the team and they can introduce themselves.
So hi, we are Team RACKlette. So yeah, we are a student HPC, let's say, cluster competition team. I think the guys from NotOnlyFlops explain pretty extensively what we do basically. So we take part in these competitions like the ISC, SC, and also ASC in Asia, online and on-site, depending on the situation. Today we have here most of the members who took part at this ISC competition. We are missing two, which could not be present. The first who we are missing is Rahul, our team captain, and Piotr. Then today we have here me, I'm Nejo, Marcel, there's also Fabio and Niklas. For this competition, we had a more traditional cluster configuration. We had four nodes, and we choose to have two GPU nodes and not to use like GPUs on all the nodes. It was more because of the power consumption. Since we were limited to 3 kilowatts, we had to make some choice and cut some computing power there. The CPUs we had were the 7742s from AMD. And as for GPUs, we had the V100s. We had some issues getting the A100s in time. So that's maybe the first story of our experience at ISC. We didn't get our GPUs in time, which maybe penalized us a little bit, but I think the judges actually took that into consideration.
And so, I would say that's very typical from the true HPC experience nowadays as well. Yeah
with all of the chip shortages, it's pretty hard to get some new hardware right now. So yeah, we got our cluster from our sponsors, which is kept at the CSCS facility. They are probably our biggest supporters, beside also our advisors, Thorsten and Hussein. And as you mentioned, we were the only team at the competition who actually used EasyBuild to, let's say, build our software. It was a choice led by, let's say, the philosophy of the team of learning new stuff. And it was suggested to us to try this new software by some people at the CSCS, and let's just say that we took the chance to try it and had a great experience with it. So, but that's something the other guys are going to talk about for each application. How was the experience with EasyBuild? And I'll pass my word to Marcel. No, Fabio, sorry, Fabio.
Yeah, right. So I'll also mention, because I think that's kind of interesting, for the online part, we had access to several clusters. I think it was three. It was Bridges 2 from PSC, Niagara from Cynet in Canada, and then also the Thor cluster from the HPC Advisory Council itself. And for some of the applications on these clusters, we actually also ended up using EasyBuild. Instead of the built-in packages. That was pretty fun. The nice thing there was that essentially once we had set up the easy configs for our software, we could just copy it over. And then if easy build was set up correctly and it was running properly on that cluster, then we could just compile the packages and essentially have the same setup on every cluster. To start out with experimenting with different options. And this usually because the home space is restricted, or at least the number of files in the home directory is restricted in clusters like this. It was kind of fun because we did some very non-standard stuff like running EasyBuild mainly on Scratch. So changing all the directories to have EasyBuild on Scratch and stuff like that. But especially given the short time frame, we ended up being a bit late with compilation, and as long as Scratch stays persistent for a week, you can do that mostly without any issues. We kind of approached it in a way that we were kind of learning by doing. So essentially learning about EasyBuild as we were trying to actually implement these things. It's the first time that we used EasyBuild. So essentially our advisor mentioned to us last summer that EasyBuild would be something good to look into. We were using SPAC before that, and some of the team members were still sticking with that. But over time, over the year, we slowly kind of rolled over to EasyBuild. So personally, I actually have no experience at all with SPAC. I started out using EasyBuild right away. But yeah, like I said, it's a fairly steep learning curve and just learning things as you start needing them. So that was kind of fun. Yeah, I didn't mention it. I was the one who mostly compiled. So I mostly compiled Icon alone with some help from the team captain, Rahul, who is not here, unfortunately. Yeah, the other interesting part was that essentially just a few days before the competition, we also decided to reset the cluster. And during that process, EasyBuild was, of course, very helpful to rebuild the entire stack, get immediately the compilation or the builds that we wanted to have with the correct build options. And also, on the other hand, at that point, since we had already used EasyBuild on the external clusters, we already had at least some experience with it and could fix most of the errors and gotchas that we would encounter. I'll switch over to Icon. What I did there, mostly I did some exploratory compiling with EasyBuild. Without EasyBuild. So I would get the source, start compiling packages, figure out exactly what configuration options I want, and things like that. We've already mentioned CDF and NetCDF and HDF5, and getting those to work with all of the parallelized options that you need for Icon can be a bit finicky. So that's why I was doing this kind of compiling by hand and then writing the easy configs as I figure out what exactly I need and want for each package. So maybe I'll throw in there that's kind of a point that for the future, maybe we can find a better way to do that, or maybe that's an idea for maybe there's a better way to do this with EasyBuild. But it seems like the source in EasyBuild itself is always kind of hidden. It's very far into this kind of tree folders directory structure. And it's very difficult to, at least with this approach, make changes for debugging to any files in the source without just cloning the source for yourself and working with that before kind of diving into EasyBuild. But yeah, in the end, no matter how that worked, in the end, this gave us the custom easy configs, and I could just copy that to all the clusters, including our own, and then just once it was set up, it really worked like a charm. So that was amazing.
Yeah, maybe I can already answer that specific part. I'm not going to claim we have a perfect solution for that, but there are some things that could help. Mm-hmm. Like one thing you could do is let EasyBuild essentially set up the build directory for you, and then let it stop right before it starts configuring the build or doing the actual build step and continuing. So you can do, there's a dash dash stop option.
Right.
And if you stop dash dash stop prepare, essentially EasyBuild will set up the build directory, unpack, maybe apply patch files, everything, set up the environment, and then stop. And then if you then manually go to that build directory, EasyBuild has everything prepared for you. There's one other thing you can do next to that. And if you combine both, I think it's close to what you need. You can let EasyBuild dump a script that sets up the build environment. And if you then source that script, you get all the environment variables like EasyBuild will set them as well. So if you combine the stop option that sets up the build directory for you and then also sourcing of that script, you're essentially in the same environment as EasyBuild will do the build as well. And in there, you can play around manually, configure, reconfigure, start from scratch again, and then gradually figure it out what you should put into the EasyConfig file. This is maybe something you didn't know. Maybe it's something we don't have good documentation on either. So that could definitely be helpful. I think there are better ways. We've discussed the idea of dropping you into an interactive shell environment. So just let EasyBuild prepare everything and then drop you right into that environment in the terminal. And I think Stack has something like this. Mm-hmm. So that's definitely an idea we could work on as well to make that interactive experience a bit better. Yeah, that's very good feedback.
I'm not sure if that's, I'm not sure if I have a good solution to this. The first option sounds interesting with the stopping the environment. But I guess in that case, every time you rebuild, the whole thing gets recreated, right? Unless you restart from that point.
Yeah, so you could just let EasyBuild prepare everything for you, and then you copy that, so you can easily restore it later and reconfigure by hand.
That's a good point to go forward with. Yeah. Okay. Cool. As soon as that stuff works, it's great because you just have a pre-built thing. As long as EasyBuild works and your easy configs are correct and the source code loads properly, which is also not always the case. Sometimes there's problems with retrieving the right source code and things like that. But I think it's not really on the side of EasyBuild. That's often with the software packagers or providers. There were a lot of interesting moments where I found myself, because of time, essentially editing files that I usually shouldn't be editing and just having kind of very dirty fixes. Not really a thing with EasyBuild, but just in general with the whole competition. So that was kind of fun.
And like I mentioned during the previous team as well, I think you got the easy experience in terms of dependencies and all the kind of trouble you could run into.
Of course,
this is just the starting point of what support teams and people who are building applications on a daily basis run into every day.
As soon as you don't want to use the newest stable release of something, you want to use something older or something more obscure, it gets very interesting. Let's see. That already more or less finishes what I had to say about econ. Having everything then on different clusters, having seen how that worked, just kind of merging it all onto the own cluster. And at that point, I really understood how to essentially modify easy configs, how they play into each other. And especially because it was a correct install of EasyBuild and not something running as a user in Scratch, everything then really kind of fit together and was very helpful for the final builds.
You mentioned you also played around with spec for a while during the preparation
Didn't other team members
some people did. So what was it, like a team decision in the sense that let's pick something and stick to that everyone so we can help each other out as well? And how was that decided? Was it a democratic vote, or did you just have a discussion on these features are interesting in EasyBuild and let's go with that? Or
I think it was a very strong recommendation from advisor. Maybe Niklas can also talk about that. But
I can talk a bit about that. Yes. Yeah. So as we already told you, we are working very closely with CSCS together, and CSCS also uses EasyBuild. And then we got some strong recommendation to also use EasyBuild since most people at CSCS are already using EasyBuild, so we can ask them questions and they can help us. And also CSCS is working with you, with you guys very closely, since they already did some crazy stuff that is some of the basic stuff where everybody builds on. And so we also have a good access to lead developers and from EasyBuild, and that's why they strongly recommended that we use EasyBuild. But then we also had, especially Rahul, our team captain, he already was using spec for like 1.5 years. And so he still used spec for the benchmarks. But for everything else, we use EasyBuild basically. And going forward, we will only use EasyBuild since all the new people that we are getting into the team, we will start them with EasyBuild.
I'll just quickly interject, since you also asked if we had a discussion. Basically, all of our team members, this was pretty much our first competition, except for Rahul. So we didn't really have the, I don't think we would have had the experience to decide based on the features what is better for us. So it really made sense to just go with what was suggested and go ahead with that.
All right. And in the end, because as far as I know, you were the only team using EasyBuild. I don't know how, if you have a good view if other teams were using it at all or using something else, but do you think this gave you an edge in the competition and you're losing less time in properly compiling stuff or checking out all the details if everything went okay the way it should have been? Did you win a lot of time thanks to that and then you could focus on other stuff? Or
again, I don't have the anything to compare to. I can't really compare to SPAC, but I have the impression that we had a lot of opportunities to make very custom builds that were still it's very easy to customize everything without breaking anything, if that makes any sense. You can customize it and still have this whole package manager experience where everything is done for you, but it's done for you in exactly the way that you want. And I think for the competition, that's very helpful. I'm not sure if other package managers like SPAC are flexible enough to do that.
So in a sense, am I getting it right that EasyBuild in some sense forced you to do things in the proper way rather than hacking around and then later regretting that and losing lots of time to figure things out again?
I guess that's one way of interpreting it as well, yeah. Because you're kind of forced to work with configurations and you can't just change some hidden files somewhere and implicitly make the system do something else. That's a good point, yeah.
Okay, good.
And also, as far as I know, we were the only team using EasyBuild at the competition.
That's still interesting to me why other people aren't picking up on it. Maybe the learning curve that you mentioned is too steep if students only essentially have a couple of weeks or months to learn everything in HPC, not only getting stuff to install. Maybe it's too big of a jump to adopt a new tool like this, unless you have people backing you where you can help.
I think it could also be that SPAC is wider known, I'd say, since most people in the HPC community they know SPAC and what SPAC can do, and not everybody I know I think knows EasyBuild, and also at the competition I think to our booth there was like five times or so came somebody from SPAC and said yeah we should use SPAC, gave us stickers and so on. So I think maybe they have like the better PR team in that regard.
Again, another thing.
After all, sorry, it is.
I'm going in like that. It's one specific characteristic of our team is that we don't do HPC like in lectures and stuff. So maybe also other students can actually be influenced also by the stuff they do during the lectures and their projects. So that might also influence the use of SPAC compared to EasyBuild or stuff like that. Meanwhile, for us, it's just a pure hobby and free time. So we can actually take the chance to learn and try different paths. And yeah.
All right.
Yep. I also have a short anecdote from, I was speaking to the people from AWS a bit. And they're doing a lot of work with SPAC. And I don't remember exactly what the situation was, but they, I think, asked what we're working with. And we said EasyBuild. And they said like, you're kind of on the European side of things. I wonder if there's also a bit of like, not clash, but kind of different mentalities here.
Yeah.
For SPAC, the idea is you want things to be sure, built custom for your system, but you want it to happen as fast as possible. And EasyBuild is more of the mentality of you really do everything exactly as you want it, and you can really touch every part of the build process. So
Yeah, and in some sense there are different use cases, and also the communities are indeed quite different. That's it's not like we're excluding people outside of Europe or something, or that SPAC is excluding people outside of the US, but that's just how things have grown over time. And there's definitely some cross usage there as well.
Yeah, I just heard that comment from someone at AWS and thought it was quite amusing.
Yeah. And in terms of stickers and stuff like this, if one of you gives me an address to send some stuff to, I'll send you not only stickers, but some coffee mugs of EasyBuild as well. So
All right.
as a thank you for using EasyBuild during the competition.
Cool. I think we should, unless there's more questions for the icon build, we can go ahead with Niklas, who's going to talk a bit about NWCAM.
Yes, so I was mainly doing the NWCAM build. I had a bit of help from Fabio at the beginning, but after he went over to ICON, I basically worked on it alone. And NWCAM was interesting to work with, since in a way it was pretty easy in the setup, but it was also pretty hard, since the documentation was not always very good. And you had to find your way through four different files to get to something. And what we ended up with was that we used the Intel compilers for everything. I think Marcel will later also talk a bit more about why we used the Intel compilers, even though we had the AMD CPUs. And there we also used iFort and ICC. And then we used OpenMPI for the communication. And there were some dependencies, but they were not really a problem to install. And once all the flags were set and all the exports were set, which was a bit difficult to find everything, then it worked fine. The only big problem was with the MPI network, since NWCAM, they want you to use ARMCI MPI, which they also have, which you also can download from them. The only problem was that the tool chain to download didn't work directly. So we had to be a bit hacky and find some other documentation to get that to work. But after that, ARMCI MPI worked fine, while other MPI versions couldn't talk to other nodes in our system. And that is a general problem in NWCAM that can sometimes happen. And basically we were told, don't worry about this, just use ARMCI MPI and don't look back, basically. Another thing we had with the MPI libraries was that we could run ARMCI MPI on multiple nodes, but we couldn't use all the cores on every node, probably because there was too much talk going on, and then we basically would crash the system. And with EasyConfig, everything worked fine. This was my first competition, my first experience with modules and so on. And apart from some difficulties at the beginning, where Fabio helped me and setting everything up, EasyBuild was good to use, and it was also very easy to pick up to change some easy configs to just get different versions, and that was a really good experience. I can't compare it to SPAC, since I have never used that, but at least once you have an easy config that's working and the install is working, then getting different easy configs with different version numbers is really easy from my point of view, and that worked really well.
All right, yeah, thanks a lot. I think I had another question that maybe fits into this. Yeah, let's ask it here. So it's not specifically to NWCAM, it's a broader question. But if you would, let's say, do the same competition again with the same applications, knowing what you know now, are there any significant changes you would make in how you approached the competition?
I mean, for me, it's not really some significant changes. I think for me, the biggest problem was that with all the university stuff and different projects there, we had to do. We had very little time for the preparation phase. And that was especially for ICON and NWChem, since we couldn't get them to run in a short order, but had to work on them some hours. And with that, I mean, if I would have known everything I know now, it would have been way easier to get it to run in the first place. And then we could have done way more different configurations to get even more performance, do some more optimization. But I mean, with all the easy configs that we already did change, for different versions, I don't think that would have been a big problem to do, since the install of the compilers, different compilers and different libraries would have been fairly easy. So I think it was in the end just knowledge about HPC and in general probably that we needed to get, and then only the time constraints. And other than that, I think we were on a good path. And we could have probably done way better with more time, but we still had a good go at it, I think.
I was just going to ask you, you guys ended up second in the competition, right? How big was the gap with the first one? Do you know?
I'm not exactly sure. It's also difficult to compare, since at the benchmarks they had the A100s and we had the V100s, so. There we can't compete. For us, I think it's more for the online part, where Marcel will also talk a bit about that later. But for the online part, we couldn't get NWChem and ICON to run the way we wanted or at all because of time constraints. And at some point just said, okay, we want to focus on the on-site competition to get it to run there. And so with more time and with more knowledge, we could have also gotten to run it at the online competition way better, and could have also had a high finish there. I think that's the main thing we missed in a way because of those constraints.
I think either we could have spent more time, or I think we were close enough that with the newer hardware we would have been in place to beat them. I think possibly, from what I've heard. Yeah.
Difficult to know up front, of course, but yeah.
Yeah.
All right. So I guess we still have Marcel who wants to share
part
of the experience as well.
Yes, okay. Absolutely. Okay, so my background is a bit different in a way that I was actually not supposed to be at ISC, but I replaced someone who couldn't be there for personal reasons. So I was kind of dropped in this whole thing after it had already started, after the online competition had been going for a few weeks at least, right? So I had a lot of catching up to do, and it had to be done quickly, and we had to get good results. I was tasked with the X-Compact 3D application, right? So we had to run some computational fluid dynamics simulations, and I was working with another teammate whose name is Piotr, who helped me out a lot in this experience. And I actually already had some background with EasyBuild because it was introduced to me by my father, who is also into HPC. So we kind of passed down this knowledge a few years back because I wanted to, back in high school, I had this idea. I really wanted to run some chemistry simulations. Because I was just interested in that. And the biggest wall, the first wall I hit was, okay, I want to use Gromax. At the time, I wanted to use Gromax. I cannot get Gromax to run, right? I couldn't compile it. And so he was like, yeah, just look into EasyBuild. And this is kind of how I got it, got introduced to it. And then I had help from someone else at CSCS, who kind of gave me like the basic fundamentals of EasyBuild. So for me, it was not exactly new. Once I logged on to the cluster for the first time, I was very quick to install EasyBuild without even knowing that other team members were already using the tool. So I just installed it in my local directory before even having a meeting with them and started testing out the application. Luckily, XCompact was really easy to compile. It only took a few minutes, and it just went all with no problems. It just compiled and it ran right away. So the issue was at that point was not really, okay, let's get the software to run. It was beating the other teams at it, because I knew that if I was able to compile it that quickly and that easily, then other teams would have been able to do that as well, right? So the task was really, okay, how can we squeeze performance out of this as much as we can, right? As much performance as we can to get the best numbers. And EasyBuild was really, really helpful in this process, because it basically gave us the power to install software in, I don't want to say minutes, but let's say hours, since you got to compile a lot of dependencies and it takes a while, but it sure is much, much quicker to install, say, the Intel compiler tool chain via EasyBuild than to sit there and manually compile everything. And this is actually something that really, really helped us. And in the end, we actually got first place on the PSC cluster when it comes to the XCompact 3D task. And we were also among the first for the other cluster. And I think a big part of that was that we decided to compile with Intel compilers on AMD hardware. And I believe that when I first logged onto the PSC cluster, which is an AMD based cluster, Bridges 2 cluster by PSC, they didn't actually offer the Intel compilers as a pre-installed package. I don't believe so. So the solution was simply to install EasyBuild and go through that, install it in either our local directory or on Scratch. I don't exactly remember where. I think it was on Scratch. And this gave us the ability to test things out without having to put too much work into it, right? And surprisingly, it was just, yeah, let's try it, right? We don't, since we're using EasyBuild, it's not gonna be a lot of work, so let's try it out, right? Instead of using GCC. And it turns out that just by compiling with Intel compilers on the specific hardware we were using, we got a like 1.4 times performance boost, which is pretty good, right? And the more we tested stuff out and we installed optional dependencies and whatnot, the more performance we got out of the application. I believe the NotOnlyFlops slide said that XCompact 3D does not have any dependencies, and in a way it doesn't, but you can install some optional software and compile it with some optional software. It supports, for example, Intel MKL and FFTW3 and some other input-output libraries and whatnot. So there is certainly some, like quite a bit of margin to test stuff out, and using EasyBuild was really, really helpful in getting those dependencies installed and just brute forcing the best possible combination, right? Because at some point you have to test things out. You can't just, you know, experience can give you a little bit of a hand in guessing or like eyeing out what works and what doesn't. But at the end of the day, testing stuff out is what got us to get such good results. And coincidentally, the hardware, the CPUs that were running on the Bridges 2 cluster were actually the same CPUs we had on our cluster. So I just had to copy paste my easy configs and my scripts to install everything back on our cluster. And we actually got first place for the XCompact 3D task at the on-site competition as well. And it was quite surprising because we got, I think it was twice the performance of the second team, or like the team behind us, and they had better CPUs, newer CPUs. So from that point of view, we got really, really good results. And of course, it was also thanks to EasyBuild, because we had time before the competition to brute force the best combination basically, and then get there. We only compiled the XCompact 3D once, did one run, and we got the best time. So like from that point of view, we were really well prepared, and it was also thanks to EasyBuild. We did some other stuff as well. We ran some like a profiler tool to check out say communication between processes. We tried to optimize other stuff as well, but a big part of it I feel was also thanks to being able to try stuff out without having to spend too much time installing dependencies and compiling stuff by hand. And, you know, you just EB, say intel.eb, and it will just install it all alone. And you don't have to really do much aside from wait and enjoy.
Yeah, keeping an eye on it, make sure it actually completes, and meanwhile, do some other stuff. Yeah.
Exactly.
Install by hand is super frustrating, trying to go through all of this one API stuff. It's very nice that EasyBuild somewhere has like the hard-coded links where you can just download the software that you want and be done with it.
Yeah. Okay. I had another question as well, which is something more general. I was wondering, since you were all pretty new to HPC, did you learn or did you run into something during the competition that today you still say, this doesn't make sense and this should change this in the way they approach it? So any tool, any aspect of managing an HPC cluster or installing software on it, where you say, this is just so weird and why is it like that? It's a bit of a surprise question, I know, but
yeah. Oof.
Maybe what was the biggest surprise? What was the weirdest thing you ran into while working on this?
Like, personally, I don't really know how to answer this question because it's my first time doing a competition, but it's not the first time I've done work on a cluster. And when I first started, you know, working with these kinds of systems, I had someone who was following me very closely and was just kind of paving the way. So I kind of learned to do stuff in a certain way, and that's just how it is, right? So I got used to it in a way. I remember at first I was very confused by modules, for example, a few years back, but now it's totally the best way to do it, or at least a very good way of doing that, right? So I think perspective changes the more you gain experience. Something that might be strange or unintuitive at first will probably become more intuitive, or you might be able to appreciate its value later on once you have a bit more of experience, right?
That's maybe something I was hinting towards. So there's a lot of things we do in HPC, in the HPC community, that's mostly due to tradition. And I think environment modules is maybe a part of that. They've been using the system since the 90s, so long before you were born, or long before your parents were even thinking of having children, probably. This was the standard way of giving people access to software on systems. And maybe this is due a revolution or a rethink, rather than people teaching other people, this is how it's done, and we've always been doing this, so you should do this as well. So I was just wondering if there's anything for you that jumped out, like, stop doing this and please fix it, make it easier, make it better.
Yes, maybe I can say something to that, since it was my first like real experience in that domain. At first, the different modules were like, okay, what is this? But I actually think that it's quite a good system. Because in that way you can fairly easily change different things, try different things, and this modular approach, I think it's actually quite good. What is still a bit strange to me, I know why it's done that way, and I can see that it is needed to set everything up, but all the export variables is sometimes quite difficult to get behind what do I need to export and what don't I need to export, especially if you have no real idea how the program is working or what it's doing in detail at every step. And then you just see different documentations and they all tell you to export different things. And in the end, you just try to put everything in there and I hope it works. And also what was interesting to me with it is that documentation is very difficult to find a good one, since even very extensive documentations, you you come to a problem where you say, okay, I can't be the first one that got here, and there's just nothing. And then you have to look into further links, and then further links and further links, just to get somewhere. And then you try everything, and at some point it works, and you never touch it again. So that was some really interesting experience for me.
Maybe to bounce that back to you, you ran into stuff where you say, we can't be the first ones that hit this, and then you've somehow fixed it. Didn't you then share the solution and wherever the question was raised, or?
I will write back to the NWCAM developers with the things I found once our system is back up again and I have access to it, to just go to all the directories again. Yeah, I mean, it's also stuff where if you talk to somebody else, they say, I know this, I encountered this before, this is the fix. And then you just, okay, why isn't it in the documentation, basically? And that was a bit strange, since in a way, if you look from outside, it's such a sophisticated field. It's a huge field. There's so much money involved. And that the documentation is just, if you come from it with no prior knowledge, it's just, okay, what is going on here? And that was really interesting to see.
Yeah. All right, yeah, I think that's a very good answer. Yeah.
And maybe if I can hop in, I feel like this is also a little bit the case with EasyBuild. We had a discussion before, we had a little private meeting before the talk, and we were kind of discussing, you know, what were the pros and the cons of EasyBuild, what we found helpful and what we didn't like very much. And something that came up was that the documentation is written or seems to be written for someone that already has experience with EasyBuild in a way, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So if we go past the installation page and how to set up everything else, it seems to be written for someone who has already experience with EasyBuild. And to be fair, most of the problems I encountered, I checked the documentation, I was not able to solve them. And then I went to the Slack channel, just wrote a little message in there, and in no time, someone came up with a solution. Mm-hmm. And Nicholas described the situation perfectly. Someone just replied with, oh yeah, I know that problem. Just do this and that's the fix, right? But nowhere does it say there's a problem with that in the documentation, or, you know, exactly what he was saying. So this is also a little bit, this also concerns in a way EasyBuild.
I think that's very true. Yeah.
So we need either an AI bot or underpaid intern to convert all of the EasyBuild, the Slack discussions into documentation on the website.
That's something I actually very actively push for, and people who often hang out in EasyBuild Slack know this, when somebody raises a question and we somehow figure it out, that we should get it documented somewhere. And very often that means make sure there's an issue for it that has the errors or whatever you were hitting. And if you figure that out yourself, post the question, close the issue, but then we have it somewhere. Because in Slack also over time, it eventually disappears, which is even a bigger problem, because, you know, 3 months ago, somebody asked this and we figured it out, but we don't have the answer anymore. That's even worse than not having it properly documented. At least it's floating around somewhere. It's difficult to be consistent there. One thing I think we did good there quite recently is the EasyBuild tutorial. I don't know if you've used that at all. So that's separate from the documentation. And there it really takes the point of view from somebody who doesn't know EasyBuild at all, and it builds up from scratch. It explains it, what EasyBuild is, how to install and configure it, how to build your own your first easy config file, and why it's done like this. So that's a bit more of a beginner view, I think, but that's maybe a bit too disconnected from the documentation currently.
I think I'm not sure if I've seen this tutorial. But if it's what I think it is, I think there were still some sections missing where it's kind of, there's kind of a disconnect between the, like you said, between documentation and tutorial, where there could be more kind of maybe interoperability, where you're saying, okay, if you're looking at this part of the documentation, this part of the tutorial will connect with that. And if you're doing this in the tutorial, like this is what's covering these parts of the documentation, and kind of.
Yeah.
That's why the documentation is structured in this way, so that kind of helps absorb information a bit better, maybe.
Yeah, certainly from documentation to tutorial, that's very true. I don't think we have a lot of pointers in that direction. The other way, I think we have a bit more, but yeah, we can definitely improve on that.
Because at some point, you're not really working through a tutorial. You're kind of looking for specific solutions to things that you're trying to do. And that will usually point you to the documentation because you're looking for keywords, right?
Yeah.
Then if that kind of had pointers to, okay, if you want to learn about this section, look at these chapters in the tutorial, that would be super helpful.
Yeah, all right, that makes a lot of sense. Okay. Do we have any other questions for the RACKlette team as well? Are you guys planning to join again in the future competition? I think the team is also joining at Supercomputing, right?
Yes, so we were at we are at SC22 in November, and so we will be in Dallas in person.
All right, excellent. And do you have any details on that competition yet, like applications or?
I think the applications are at least at some part online. Let me check real quick.
If you give us a stack of stickers, we can put them to our booth and compete with the SPAC people running around trying to give their stickers away.
All right, a batch of stickers and some coffee mugs are coming up. Yeah, and you have, as long as you use the coffee mugs in at SC, then I'm sure they reach you in time.
Some merch for us and some merch to give away at the competition.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay. Yeah, well, he's looking at those applications. I'm just, usually when people tell me applications, I know if they're supported in EasyBuild or not by heart. And if they're not, it's maybe something we can work on together as well in preparation to the competition, since you do have some time to prepare there. That's maybe something the community can also help out with. That could be interesting. Okay, do we have any questions popping up, Simon? I see Sam has raised a question on NWChem, but they already answered it in Slack. So yeah, let me raise the question. Maybe you can echo the answer as well. So the question was, did you use the NWChem easy config file from the EasyBuild repository? And if yes, did you make any changes to improve that performance?
Yeah, so Niklas can also correct me on this if I'm wrong, but as far as I know, we definitely had source provided, and I think there may have been some alterations to the default NWChem source.
Yes, I think so. We had a source provided, and they basically told us to work with that, and so we did use that and didn't download the NWChem from EasyBuild.
Honestly,
I actually saw that it was there, but we just tried to follow their solutions, because they also had some stuff they told us to set for the exports, but it was in no way, I think we had to double the amount of exports extra. And that's the thing I didn't realize before. So maybe for the next competition, I look at both at the same time.
So you actually checked the EasyBuild repository for NWChem?
I think I searched for it, saw that it was there, but then didn't use it.
It never even crossed my mind to do that, because like for all of these applications, we already get a specific repository to use. And I think for Econ, I checked for fun to see if EasyBuild has something for that. I don't believe they do, at least at the time.
No, I don't think so.
So I didn't even think about that for NWChem, but could be interesting to compare it as soon as we get access to the cluster again and see. I don't know. Maybe we can contribute. Maybe Niklas can contribute some configuration options to the easy configs.
Maybe something we can do. Maybe something we can do in preparation for SE is have a separate call where we show some more advanced features of EasyBuild, and in particular how you can easily customize installations with EasyBuild. So we have this hooks approach where you can write some small Python function, which basically hooks in a specific part and stall step, for example, where you can tweak some things that EasyBuild does by default. And that way you can get some, yeah, some pretty good control over what EasyBuild does if there's something you don't like or something you want to play around with, without using your own stack of easy config files and having to copy everything, basically. We do have some good ways of dealing with that. So that's maybe something interesting to show you and then also look into together how you can leverage that in the competition.
That would be really cool, yes. So the applications, I mean, it's Linpack for the benchmark, then HVCG for the benchmark, then IO500 benchmark. And then for the applications, it's FASTA and LAMS.
Okay, yeah, but both of those are in EasyBuild, I think. And I think LAMS, that's gonna be an interesting one. Because if you're looking for something that has a lot of knobs to turn, LAMS definitely fits that. So that's gonna be a fun one to play with.
I better finish my PR then.
Yeah, Alan has spent quite a bit of time on that in EasyBuild already, and there's some open pull requests we have there as well. Okay.
One other cool thing that would be nice to have for future competitions, I don't think we need it for SC, but online competitions, would be some way to, some easier or more standard way to put, to run EasyBuild as a user on a production cluster where you don't have, where you're not the system administrator. That's like also one of the things that was, that kind of played into your question earlier that surprised me with EasyBuild is just the absolute waterfall of files that EasyBuild produces and puts in your file system. Because if you talk to system administrators with this who maybe haven't heard about EasyBuild before, they're just like, well, your HPC software is not supposed to make a lot of small files. And EasyBuild does exactly that. So yep. It would be very cool to have some way of using EasyBuild in a very confined environment. Of course, I don't know if people need that enough that anyone would want to work on that. But it would definitely be very nice for online competitions.
There's definitely some tricks we can share there to make that easier, a lot less painful. Yeah. Kurt, you had some comments as well?
Yeah, I mean, spec is about as bad in that. It's just a property of being Python software.
Yeah.
Python that is the disaster. It's not EasyBuild.
I'm wondering if there's some way to, on the fly, untar the files that are needed and then kind of have everything else in some kind of tar archive.
Well, one thing you could definitely do is install EasyBuild in the container image. And then essentially, if you run it through Singularity, so run EasyBuild itself through Singularity, everything is one big file. And then you don't have all those small files on the file system. You're essentially pulling stuff from one big container image.
But then
that could already be a big help.
If you have access to Singularity. I don't know about other clusters, but for example, on the ETH cluster, Singularity is limited to shareholders.
But yeah, but there they have shifter, which is pretty much the same thing. So you could prepare the container image that not shifter, but what's the other tool? They have their own Saris. They have their own container tool. And you could prepare a container image that works with all these container tools, container runtime. So that's definitely possible. And there's other tricks you can pull as well.
So we could also have some kind of workshop on that or update the documentation for tricks like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
If you don't have access to Singularity on the CSCS cluster, then that's probably because
not CSCS.
They have a commercial license, and because you cannot have two instances of Singularity on the cluster because the Cray software just comes with Singularity. So they must have replaced the Cray software with a different version of Singularity, which they cannot give to all users.
I'm not sure about CSCS. I'm talking about the ETH internal Euler cluster, which is hosted at CSCS, but I think the administration...
That might already be a difference.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, on Cray system, Singularity is just the standard container environment for Cray.
There's probably still some way to containerize it, so yeah.
Yeah, there's... If you're a little bit creative, you can work around any issues. Okay, thanks a lot. I think we're close to yeah, to wrapping up. Very interesting to hear your experience as well. And yeah, it's clear it's a very maybe different approach, maybe more traditional approach compared to the not only flops team. But yeah, very interesting. I'm very happy to hear that EasyBuild was a very good help. And hopefully that will remain the same if you join more competitions like this. And as you already know, yeah, if there's anything we can help with as an EasyBuild community, please reach out. And the EasyBuild Slack is the best way of doing that.
Maybe if I can take 1 minute before we close to do a little bit of advertising. We sure. Actually have some, if you guys are interested, we have some visualizations of the work we did up on YouTube. So I'm going to just post the link in the chat. So just to see a bit what the output of our work was. I'm going to post a few links in the Zoom chat.
And yeah, you should do the same in the Slack Tech Talks channel as well.
All right.
There at least the links are gonna stay there for a while, and the Zoom chat they will disappear.
Okay, I'll post it there instead.
Excellent. Any last words from the not only flop teams as well before we wrap it up? Oh, I don't think we have sound, but. Hear you. Anyway, just a wave is fine as well. All right, thanks a lot. This was fun. And maybe
thank
we
you
should,
for having us.
Yeah, maybe we should make this a yearly thing and have some teams report back on how they did during the competition. This was very interesting.
You have at least one team using EasyBuild now, so
yeah, maybe more in the future. Who knows?
One is better than zero already.
Yes.
Next year we'll have a team using Easy to set our projects we're interested in.
Yes, that's also something we should show you because that could save you quite a bit of trouble as well. If we're talking about installing compilers and dependencies from source, what if they are just sitting there and you could start using them straight away without having to do anything? So that's something the Easy project is aiming to do. So that's definitely also something we should talk about. All right, thanks a lot, everyone. And see you around.
Thank you for having us.
Bye-bye.
Yes, thank you for having us. See you. Bye-bye.